Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the First Unitarian Fellowship of Nanaimo. My name is Bill Wolverton, and I'm your service leader this morning. Whatever your ethnicity, theological belief, gender, sexual orientation, age, and everything else that makes you who you are, please know that you are warmly welcome in our community. If this is your first time with us, a very special welcome to you. If you're joining us online, please consider sharing your contact information with us. We'd love to welcome you to the community. We have a wonderful website, ufon.ca, that's ufon.ca, and invite you to check it out for more detailed information about who we are, the services we offer, and how you can connect with us. We acknowledge today that we meet on the traditional territory of the Shunemuk First Nation. As Unitarians, we are committed to the work of reconciliation required to address the harm done to all Indigenous peoples and their cultures by non-Indigenous peoples. We have much to learn from the Indigenous perspective that the earth is the source of all life and that our responsibility is to honor and care for it. It is time for today's announcements. We thank Bev Locke for the lovely flowers on the screen this morning. There are two seats left for the Meaningful Membership Workshop starting on Tuesday. You can call the office if you're interested or see Lee's after the service. And note that there will be a town hall after the service today. And from the Nanaimo Green Faith Circle, 100 trees that had been planted last spring at a Green Faith Circle event were unfortunately taken down this June. The Nanaimo Green Faith Circle invites you to help replant these trees on Saturday, November 19th at 10:30 a.m. The planting location is just north of the playground at Bevan Park. We especially welcome people who donated or planted the original trees. Please dress for the weather and bring work gloves. City Parks will provide trees and tools. For more info, contact nanaimogreenfaith@gmail.com. And Brian Short has more from the Environmental Committee, Environmental Justice Committee.
Well, I'm so excited. I just can't hide it. I'm not going to break out in song. The Environmental Justice Committee has got some real treats for you guys next weekend. On Saturday night, we're having a panel. You've probably heard about it, read about it, because everybody reads the newsletter every month and they update every week. Starts at 7 o'clock. We've got 3.5, 4 panelists that are going to be here and talking about how they have been in the been climate activists for a long time, and what keeps them going, keeps them happy, what keeps them from the despair that we sometimes feel in climate action. And then on Sunday morning, the service will be done by Carl Perrin, who's also one of the panelists. He's been doing climate action for 50 years. Is a member of the Vancouver Unitarian Church, and he's coming over and he's going to do more of, gratitude and climate action and how he also carries on in this time of despair. And that brings me to another part of this is the, I know a lot of people I talk to just feel like it's just overwhelming. It's just, they see the weather, they see the news, and the whole climate crisis just gets them down. And people that I know that are active in this all know that doing action makes you feel better. And well, when there's a refugee crisis, and we all saw it in the news, we at FUFON sponsored a refugee and brought them in. And when we go out in the streets and see people that are homeless, we at FUFON went and made a shelter. And now we see the climate crisis and we're doing a panel and doing some action and getting out there and making things better. So I'm just saying as things that we have done, we should be proud of, and we should be. We've done great work. And also humbly we walk here because there's a lot more work to be done. But I'm suggesting that we go out and talk to your neighbors or your friends or your hairstylists and everything else and invite them to our Saturday night and Sunday morning services, not just so they can come to the panel, but maybe they might want to stay and come back and get that good feeling that we get from doing the good work that we do. And finally, we need some snacks. So there's a sign-up sheet at the back. where you can sign up. We need people to bring snacks for Saturday night, whatever you want to bake. So if healing their hearts doesn't help them or doesn't get them to come back, maybe the food will. Thank you.
To find out about all special events, groups, and meetings taking place in the fellowship, either go to the calendar on our website or read the weekly update email sent you on Thursdays. Now let us enter into sacred time. Please ensure that you turn off your cell phones or put them on to vibrate if you haven't done so already. Patrick, our music director, will lead us into worship through music.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody. It's my pleasure to welcome a now familiar face. you were looking like I was going to say something else there. This is my friend and colleague, fantastic singer Bua, and we're going to do a song to get us started. This is something a little bit different. It's by a band that I love called Lake Street Dive, and they're touring the world right now, being fantastic. And this is one of their great songs. It's called "How Good It Feels."
Fun on my own. I want the whole world to know I'm having so much fun all alone. I want to let somebody know how good it feels to be alone. How good it feels to be alone. I'm having so much fun by myself. I want the whole world to know that I don't need anybody else to roll my boat. How good it feels to have somebody to make conversations with. How good it feels to have nobody to keep up relations with. How good it feels to be
how good it feels to be together again and to see your mostly smiling faces here in the hall and all your, I hope, smiling faces at home. Thank you, Bua. It's so good to be together again with you, with us here today. And it's also good to be reminded that we have a both and situation. It's wonderful to feel alone sometimes. That special, special, solitary beingness. And it's also at the same time wonderful that we have friends and family that we can be with in a community like this. It's good to be alive, and it's good to be aware that we're going to die. And I don't mean that to be a heavy statement, and it's not my intention to make you feel uncomfortable. Both living and dying are just facts. No surprises there, and I really hope that's not the first time you've heard this. And if it is, there's a story for all ages coming up that will help explain it. Did you know that the people of Bhutan are said to be the happiest people in the world? And one of the reasons it's said that they are is because they practice thinking about their dying 5 times a day. And if you would like to practice this as well, I have an app for you. It's called We Croak. And if you download this app, then it will remind you in lovely little pithy gems of wisdom that we all share mortality. So how we live our lives between being born and having to die is the focus of today. This morning, we're talking about change, which is the theme for November. Change and our lives. The inevitable changes that we will encounter in our lives are aging that we share together. Nobody gets really out of it. And that leads to that unchangeable fact of our death. So I invite you to settle in for the ride. Hopefully we'll share a few laughs together. And now we'll light our chalice.
We are all here to grow in wisdom and learn how to love better. As we each do this in our own ways, we slowly become a blessing to those around us and a light to the world.
So for our first song today, we're going to sing together number 1003 from our blue book, Where Do We Come From? And thank you to the slide sharers for showing the lyrics. And please rise as you're willing and able, because we're going to do something a little bit different. There's going to be no piano involved. We're going to sing a cappella, believe it or not. All right, we'll get started and follow us. Here we go. Where do we come from? What are we? Where are we going? Where do we come from? What are we? Where are we going? Where do we come from? Mystery, mystery, life is a riddle and a mystery. Mystery, mystery, life is a riddle and a mystery. Where do we come from? Where are we going? Where do we come from? Where do we come from? What are we? Where are we going? Where do we come from? What are we? Where are we going? Where do we come from? Where
Mystery, mystery, life is a middle and mystery. Where do we come from? Where are we going? Where do we come from? Where are we going?
And in our living, between being born and dying, we love and we grieve, we sing and we play, we get sick and we heal. And sometimes we are frightened, lonely, or angry, and we need others to comfort us or stand with us or sing with us. Our sung meditation this morning, led by Bua, is called When I Am Frightened. I'm going to invite everyone to stay seated. You can have your eyes open or closed and just listen to Bua sing this song. If you would like to sing, I invite you to sing gently under your breath. And when the song is over, we'll share 2 minutes of silence together. And then I will invite you to think of the people who support you or have supported you when you were feeling vulnerable at different times in your life. Let us meditate.
Questions with me. If you will show me acceptance, then I may learn to give as you do. Then I may learn to give. When I am troubled, will you listen to me? When I am lonely, will you be my friend? Will you be there for me? Comfort me tenderly. Will you share some of your feelings with me? If you will show me commitment, then I may learn to love. Then I may learn to love.
And now, as we enter into our 2 minutes of silence, I invite you to think of the people who have supported you in your life when you were feeling vulnerable. And as you think of them, allow your gratitude to flow out toward them. I don't remember my first steps when I was a baby, but I do remember the changes in my body at puberty. Body hair was fascinating and exciting back then, but now not so much. I remember my first gray hairs, which were also fascinating. And then the few turned to the many, and the descent into aging gained momentum. Now it's the liver spots and the dry patches and the gravity-induced descent of skin. Everything is going downhill. The ads on my phone, they tell me that I should be very worried about these changes. Somehow, Google knows that I need wider shoes, compression socks, wireless bras, chair yoga, and a lot of vitamins. How about you? Can we make a list of all the thoughts that go through our heads about the aging descent? The aches and the pains, the medications, and the replacements of worn out parts. The culture we live in tells us that as we age, we are going to hell in a handbasket, that our lives will be nothing more than pain and misery. We will lose our homes, our friends, our freedoms. We will be isolated, limited in our choices, and very unhappy. These fears are unnecessary. Let's get some perspective. 6.8% of Canadians over 60 are in assisted living or nursing homes. That means 93.2% of you are not. Fears of dementia? Worldwide, which means mostly Western first world, dementia in the over 60 age group is between 5 and 7%, depending on the country that you live in. That means 95 to 93% of the people in this world do not have dementia. The real epidemic is anxiety over the memory loss. Aging is normal. Our anxiety about it is not. Let's address the fear. Weirdly, it starts early in our lives, like all the isms, right? Sexism, racism, ageism, which is a socially constructed way of thinking about older persons based on negative attitudes and stereotypes about aging, starts before we are even teenagers. All stereotypes are based on othering other people. Seeing others as different, as a negative difference, a difference that we are taught is a barrier that we don't want to cross or should not cross. Some of us then internalize these negative stereotypes. Do you know that if you talk to an older person with a baby voice, "Oh, dearie, how are you? Do you want some help across the street?" people will immediately start acting enfeebled. And we do it to ourselves. All prejudices rely on our believing our future is grim. We choose to jump into that descending handbasket. "Oh, I'm too old to do that, dress like that, move like that, look like that, feel like that." In an absolutely wonderful and funny TED talk called "Let's End Ageism," Ashton Applewhite asks her audience this question: why do we stop celebrating our ability to adapt and change simply because we are aging? Some of you might remember this poem. It's called "Warning" by Jenny Joseph. When I'm an old woman, I'm going to wear purple with a red hat, which doesn't go and doesn't suit me. And I shall spend my pension on brandy and summer gloves and satin sandals and say we've no money for butter. I shall sit down on the pavement when I'm tired and gobble up samples in shops and press alarm bells and run my stick along the public railings and make up for the sobriety of my youth. I shall go out in my slippers in the rain and pick flowers in other people's gardens and learn to spit. You, and I think she's talking to the men now, you can wear terrible shirts and grow more fat and eat 3 pounds of sausages at a go, or only bread and pickles for a whole week, and hoard pens and pencils and beer mats and things in boxes. But now, we must have clothes that keep us dry and pay our rent and not swear in the street and set a good example for the children. We must have friends to dinner and read the papers. But maybe I ought to practice a little now, so people who know me are not too shocked and surprised when suddenly I am old and start to wear purple. Yeah. What people have loved about that poem, which was written in 1961, was the spirit of it, the fun, the sheer audacity that overturns the basket of that aging stereotype. The character in the poem reclaims their freedom to choose. I think one of the biggest fears we have about aging is losing our freedoms. The freedom in particular to be independent. In particular, the freedom to choose for ourselves what we eat, how we dress, where we go, and who we spend our time with. If one of our values is independence or self-reliance, then we must be clear and consistent and plan to tell others about it before we are faced with losing that independence. I learned an important lesson from a woman in one of the congregations I've served years ago, a lesson about fear and independence and choices. Jenny, not her real name, was in her early 80s. She'd lived with a disability most of her life that meant that she was limited in her ability to walk. She had had a lifetime to hone her independence despite these disabilities. She was resourceful, proud, and independent. She was also cranky and stubborn and vulnerable, like so many people I know. Mirror, mirror on the wall. And as Jenny aged, she needed more help living at home. Being also practical, she got that help. Tools to open jars and the fridge. And when she needed a wheelchair to get around, the furniture got rearranged so she could move through the apartment easily. She asked people in to help clean, to help shop, and she remained, for her, independent. Which for Jenny meant she made her own choices based on what she valued. Jenny valued community, and so she got herself to church most every Sunday. She also valued friends. On Tuesdays, she went to the local pub to hang out with her friends. On Thursdays, she went to visit her boyfriend, who also got around in a wheelchair. On Saturdays, they went sailing. Yes, she loved sailing, adaptive sailing, where an able-bodied person assisted her. Jenny maintained a life of independence based on what she valued. I knew her just after she had had to give up her driver's license. It didn't stop her from doing everything I described. She just got used to taking the bus or handy dart. And then she started to fall and not be able to get herself up. At first, she'd joke about the unexpected visits by buff young firemen who arrived to lift her up off the floor. But the injuries from the falls began to take their toll, and hospital visits grew more frequent. And Jenny had to face the fact that her value of independence was going to take a new turn. Over the past 2 weeks, some members of the congregation, this congregation, participated in a series of advanced care planning workshops where we talked about aging and end-of-life choices. In order to know what we might want later in life, we reflected on what we value. Some of the values that came up were community, equality, independence, sustainability, security, and joy. And there are a whole lot more. Then we thought about how our values could be supported as we age, as our physical bodies changed, became less dependable. And we thought about how we could choose to face our death, not from fear, but by honoring and living from our values. Fear and freedom, they're dance partners. The only way I know how to address the fears is to face them, name them, and talk about them. And this process is empowering. Talking about aging and dying and the choices that we can make based on the values that our values empowers us, and it also respects our freedom to choose at any age. Because as we age, our physical abilities will change. That's inevitable. It's part of living. But we can adapt our freedoms to our situations, as Jenny did. Aging and dying doesn't have to be a descent into hell in a basket. And it is not healthy going through life dreading our futures. One thing I've learned about and from advanced care planning workshops, is that we need to think about our aging as early as possible, not put our heads in the sand and pretend that it won't happen to us. That is just silly and unhelpful and ultimately disempowering. It's human to be vulnerable, to be afraid. And it's human to be afraid of what we can't control. And it is brave to face what we're afraid of. We gain freedom when we face our fears at any age. I'm on a mission to make sure that everyone in this community embraces their aging and their dying. It's the smart thing to do. So please, talk about your thoughts, your fears, and what's important to you with your partners, with your friends, your neighbors, your family, so that they know and can support you in the choices that you make. And start today. Be sure they know what you value, what you want, and what you don't want. And then relax and enjoy this wonderful life. There are limitless choices as we age. So get creative, have fun, relish your days, your pleasures, and your loves. Relish every moment and give thanks for all that you have. Thank you for listening. So now we're going to sing one of my favorite songs. This is one of those songs where you need to have lots of breath. get your lungs full, and it will get our hearts beating. It's called Turn the World Around. Patrick and Bua, over to you.
Okay, well, here we go. Please stand as you're willing and able. Sorry for the microphone adjustment here. Thank you to the slide sharers for the lyrics. Here is Turn the World Around.
Sunlight, turn the world around. Heart is off the river, body is the mountain, spirit is the sunlight, turn the world around. We are of the spirit, truly of the spirit, only can the spirit turn the world around. Oh, so is life, Abatiwa. So is life. Oh, so is life, Abatiwa.
The Greening Tree Project is your opportunity to tell us your stories about what you have done that might be called climate action. Anything counts as long as it is recent. The stories can be about a minute long. We can do a couple of people a week, and you are encouraged to do more than one story over the course of the year. Does anyone wish to tell their story today? Please raise your electronic hand on Zoom or come to the mic near the tree.
This may or may not be a green leaf, but it is. I was interviewed about my composting at Pacific Gardens, and it'll be on. It's a program called Transition Nanaimo, and I think it'll be on Tuesday of some sort if you're interested in an interview that went all over the place.
Thank you, Ron. Go ahead.
Hi. Hello. We're just in the initial stages of a bus buddy trip. Anybody wants to join us? It's going to be Thursday, the week of the 14th of November. We're going to all get on the same bus and go up to Parksville, okay, from wherever you are. So your idea is get on the certain bus to coordinate with the time. So Carolyn and Liz, and hopefully Gloria can come, and we'll have a party on the bus, and then we'll go have lunch and then shop at SOS. Anybody's welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura. You might feel that your leaf is just a tiny flutter in the wind, but it will help strengthen our tree, and in turn our tree will help build a forest towards a just, safe world for all. Now that we're both online in the hall, we welcome your donations and pledges in three different ways. First, we have set up the Unitarian Fellowship bank account to automatically deposit e-transfers sent to info@ufon.ca. Second, you can write a check and pop it in the mail. Third, if you're in a hall, there is a basket in the back of the room where you can place your donation after the service. Our charity for this month is the Nanaimo Unitarian Shelter. If you would like to donate to the designated charity, please note on your e-transfer a check. And I believe if you want to do directly to shelter, I think it's shelter@ufon.ca. We are grateful for your offering. We are nearing the end of our service. After we sing Carry the Flame, you have the opportunity to join a social group. There are breakout rooms available online for the next 30 minutes. In the hall, we will be setting up snacks for social time. Note that the town hall will start at online and in the hall at 12:30 p.m. Thank you for your participation today.
Our closing words this morning. Change, it's ever present. Change courses like a river through us and among us. May freedom and wisdom live in us and lead us to the edge of life. May our gratitude for all that we have in this moment, our bodies, our imaginations, our love, and our ability to choose what is important to us, rise up in our hearts, spilling over into all that we experience. And may we enjoy the ride.
We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
All right. It's now time to sing Carry the Flame. So we invite everybody to stand up, form a circle, join hands, or bump elbows, if that is your preference. And the lyrics are on the wall right behind me if you need to look at them.
Thank you.